I'm speaking to you at the very time when the House of Commons is debating a momentous decision, a decision which will undoubtedly impact in a more serious way on the lives and destinies of the peoples of these islands. David Cameron is hell-bent on dragging the British people into a war. With indecent haste, he has decided in his wisdom that it is necessary for Britain to join the bombing campaign against the so-called Islamic State, not just in Iraq, which of course they're already doing, but in Syria itself. Now, this represents a fundamental change in the position of Britain in this conflict. And the first question that one must ask is why? Why does Mr. Cameron insist with such vehemence on the necessity of doing this? You will recall that not long ago, the last time around, he was pressing for a campaign of bombing Syria, yes, but of bombing what? Of bombing the Assad regime in Syria. That was supposed to be in the national interest. That was supposed to be a vital question which he insisted that Britain must do. Now, on the other hand, he's changed his tune. He's discovered that it's in the national interest, it's in Britain's vital interests, to bomb not the Assad regime at all, but to bomb ISIS, which of course is fighting against the Assad regime. What arguments does he put forward? Well, of course, the need to defend Britain against terrorism. You know, one can hardly imagine a greater invitation, a better way of putting the British people, of putting millions of innocent men and women in harm's way, of deliberately inviting terrorist attacks, such as the one you saw in Paris, than by doing just this. Incidentally, let's be clear about this. From a military point of view, from the point of view of an effective struggle against ISIS, who of course, everything that he says about these people is correct, they are monsters, they are inhuman, they are cruel, they are barbaric, they are murderous, they are our enemies, the enemies of the British people, oh yes, all that is perfectly true. But you see, purely from the point of view of military effectiveness, what possible impact could the sending of a couple of British fighter jets to bomb Raqqa, what possible effect would that have on the outcome of the bloody conflict that is taking place in Syria? I answer, no effect whatsoever. It is a nonsense, it is a bluff, it is a deception of the British people to even suggest such a thing, when everybody knows it's not true, from the generals downwards. Everybody, Cameron knows, the man is lying in his teeth. When he argues, oh, we're declaring war on ISIS, I answer, no such thing. Everybody knows, every sane person, every military strategist is well aware, and it's been said so many times, there's no point in repeating it, that in any case, bombarding from the air, even if it were in sufficient numbers, which in Britain's case it clearly would not be, that bombing by air alone cannot win wars. Least of all can it win this particular war in Syria. Apart from anything else, these jihadi creatures are, of course, they're small groups split up in tunnels and goodness knows what. So therefore the bombing, as far as ISIS, as far as their fighting capacity is concerned, will have no effect whatsoever. What will happen, of course, and this is a source of serious concern to many people, logically, is that the people who will be killed will not be ISIS fighters in the main. One or two of them may be unlucky enough to fall under a British bomb. But no, most of the people that will be killed will be innocent men, women and children, which, by the way, of course, plays into the hands of ISIS. It's the best possible way that one could imagine of recruiting new fighters, new fanatics, to the ranks of these people. Oh, yes, but Mr. Cameron, of course, this man has got a nail for every hole, hasn't he? He's got a cast iron alibi. Oh, no, he says, Britain's contribution will be different to the awful Russians and even the Americans and so on. Our fighters, you see, have got pinpoint bombs. They engage in pinpoint bombing, which will take out, what a lovely expression that they use, instead of murder or slaughter, you take out people these days, it seems. It just takes out the enemy, it doesn't touch ordinary civilians. Now, of course, if you believe this, you can believe anything. There is no such thing as pinpoint bombing, good heavens above. You've got the proof of this. It was even on the television in Channel 4 last night. The amount of the hundreds, the thousands probably, of civilians that were killed by British bombing, by Allied bombing, in Iraq and in Afghanistan. The proof is that they've paid hundreds and millions of pounds in compensation to those cases which they've admitted, and they haven't admitted very many. So that is a lie. It is a despicable lie from a man who is a complete hypocrite and a moral degenerate, as a matter of fact. This is just a deception of the people. The bombing will have to, and then he says, oh, no, don't forget, we will have troops on the ground. You see, we have allies, if you didn't know that. We've got allies in Syria, you didn't know that. Well, I'll tell you. Who are these allies? Mr. Cameron says, and therefore we must believe him. Being the Prime Minister of Great Britain, we have to believe the man. What does he say? We have 70,000 allies, no less, in the Free Syrian Army. Yes, but what is the Free Syrian Army? This question has been asked and asked and asked. It was asked recently by the Foreign Affairs Select Committee, which is an all-party committee in Westminster. They grilled the general responsible for this. The representative of the armed forces was asked time and again, what do these 70,000 fighters consist of? Well, we have the answer. It's been stated that there are at least 120 groups, armed groups, one of which, I'm told, one of whom have got 58 factions. That's not bad. It's a bit like one of the left groups in Britain. 58 factions. Yes, and all of these creatures, let's be clear about, let's call a spade a shovel for once. All of these so-called moderates, moderate oppositionists, that's the buzz word, are in fact jihadis. They are Islamic fanatics like IS. You couldn't put a needle between them. You couldn't put a sheet of paper between them. There is no difference between these creatures. And these gangsters, these jihadi gangsters of the so-called Free Syrian Army, or whatever they call themselves, are what is supposed to move on the ground with the support of British bombs, one or two British bombs, that is. They're supposed to then move in by some miracle and take over Raqqa and defeat ISIS. Isn't it strange how this army has signally failed to take anything from ISIS for the whole of the last period, for the simple reason that they're not fighting ISIS. They're fighting Assad, who now, de facto, is supposed to be our ally. Although they're not prepared to say this in public. Assad, after all, is fighting ISIS. Let's be clear about that too. This 70,000 so-called fighting force of moderate opposition, it is a product of Mr. Cameron's distempered imagination. It is a phantom army. 70,000, there are not 70, they might be 70. Well, that I might just about accept. There might be 70 of these idiots who ran away from the Syrian army. Syrian army's not worried about them because they ran like rabbits. And these 70,000, or 70 more like, the jihadis are going to defeat ISIS. Well, no such thing, of course. This is nonsense. If finally, or when finally, Raqqa does fall, I believe it probably will eventually fall, the only force that can take it is Assad's forces, the official Syrian army, which with Russian assistance, of course, has been advancing. It's the only effective force on the ground, together with Iranian allies, Hezbollah and so on and so forth. It's the Syrian army that's done all of the fighting against ISIS in the last period. The others are nothing. The others are nothing. And therefore, it's a nonsense what this man is saying. It is a deception, I repeat, to the British people. An even greater deception, and it's about time that this was stated publicly, I think the reality is beginning to impinge on the consciousness of people in Britain, is that Turkey and Saudi Arabia are actively supporting ISIS and the other jihadi lunatics and cutthroats, and have been doing so systematically for the whole of the last period, supposed to be our allies. What has Mr. Cameron got to say about this? What has he got to say about the Saudis with their Wahhabi poison, which is the ideology of ISIS, with their crucifixions and beheadings? What's he got to say? He hasn't got anything to say. This is the kind of moral bankruptcy, this is the kind of rotten, disgusting hypocrisy that the Tories and the British ruling class represent. What is his real motive in this? Well, Mr. Cameron, of course, has got several motives. First of all, he believes, in his deluded frame of mind, he still believes, apparently, that Britain is a great world power. Well, I beg to differ with you, Mr. Cameron. Everybody in their right mind knows that Britain ceased to be a great world power quite a long time ago, thanks to Margaret Thatcher, who destroyed our industry and the rest of it. Britain is now a fairly backward little offshore island off the coast of Europe. That's what it boils down to, despite all his pretensions. But Mr. Cameron and the Tory madmen that support these actions are determined that Britain will be present in Syria, Britain will be around the negotiating table. In fact, the real reason is not even that. Let us call a spade a spade. The real reason is that Britain has now become so insignificant in world affairs that it is a complete satellite and tool of American imperialism, and therefore they've got to please their masters in Washington. That's what it's about. Same with the French, by the way. They're trying to please Big Brother in Washington by futile gestures which do nothing to fight against ISIS, but which do everything. Yes, let's be clear about it. What these people are doing is acting in such a provocative way that they turn their own populations, their own civilian populations, into targets for these crazy people, these psychopaths. And I'll predict now, sorry to say this, but it is as plain as a pikestaff. As night follows day, if the House of Commons votes for this action, and I believe they will, everything seems to be pointing in that direction, because of the campaign that's taken place, the lies that have been told, the arms that have been twisted in recent weeks, Mr. Cameron may well get his majority. And as night follows day, after the first bomb falls on Raqqa, preparations will be made for some kind of terrorist atrocity in London, in Birmingham, in Glasgow, in Swansea, anywhere you like, on the lines of the atrocities that were committed in Paris. That's that would be the result. And they'll turn around and they'll say, no, it's a moral question, we had to do this. It was to defend our people. How on earth do you defend your people by turning them into targets for these jihadi madmen? This is the question which needs to be put. So that it is an open and shut case, as far as I'm concerned, that any reasonable person, any Democrat, any serious person that wants to defend the millions of people, the ordinary people of Great Britain, not the Westminster clique and their backers in the City of London and the general staff of the army, that's not Britain. Britain is the millions of ordinary working people that have worked and struggled to create the wealth and the success of Britain such as it is. By these actions, they're going to turn us into a target. And therefore, the entire weight of the Labour movement, the trade unions, the Labour Party must unite in opposing this criminal action. Absolutely criminal. Not just criminal, but crazy. You know what the ancient Greeks used to say. Those who the gods wish to destroy, they first make them mad. Well, this is madness from any point of view. And yet, despite the fact that the overwhelming majority of the members of the Labour Party, Jeremy Corbyn, has stated that he's received 70,000 emails, and that's just the pick of the tip of the iceberg. The majority of the British people, insofar as they've been consulted, and they've not been consulted, but that's democracy, of course. It's democracy. Ask Tony Blair, who took Britain into a criminal war, which was the start of all this lunacy, without consulting the British people. No, in defiance of the express will of the British people. That's democracy, according to these people. Democracy is where you defy and deny the will of the majority. The Labour Party is overwhelmingly opposed. The population, insofar as I've seen unofficial opinion polls, at least 60% are opposed to this. And yet our so-called representatives in the Mother of Parliament are proceeding to vote against the will of the people, and above all, against the will, the declared, the express, the clear will of the overwhelming majority of Labour Party members. And yet we have the scandal, the abomination of the parliamentary Labour, this clique of careerists in the main, in the shadow cabinet. Why on earth Jeremy Corbyn decided to put a person like Hillary Benn in the shadow cabinet, it beggars the imagination. I've got an opinion on that, which I'll express in a moment. But here you have this tiny clique of careerists, right-wing Blairites careerists, completely and absolutely out of touch with reality. Completely and absolutely out of touch with the Labour Party that elected them, and with the electorate that elected them. These barons, you know. I mean, I thought that the divine right of kings was abolished in this country under Oliver Cromwell by the procedure, the very democratic and direct procedure of separating the king's head from his shoulders. You know, I mean, this is old stuff. And yet, we have here not the divine right of kings, but the divine right of Labour MPs. That's what it boils down to. Here I am, ladies and gentlemen, and here I sit. These people, these careerists, that's what they are. Professional, cynical careerists are sitting in their privileged positions thanks to the hard work of Labour Party members. And they say, in effect, to Labour Party members, you do or think or say what you like. I will decide. I am the boss. Oh, yes. And the real slogan of these Blairite interlopers, these Blairite infiltrators, that's what they are. They have a very clear slogan. Rule or ruin. Either you, the members of the Labour Party, either you allow me to do just what I want in defiance of your opinion, in defiance of party policy. The declared policy of the elected party leaders, so it's quite clear on this question, either you allow me to go my own sweet way and vote with the Conservatives and support a Conservative, a reactionary Tory government and help David Cameron out of a hole, which he was in a hole prior to this. That's another reason that he decided to go to war. They were defeated thanks to the opposition of Corbyn and others who have been playing the role of an opposition at last. They were forced to retreat on the question of tax credits and other issues. The Tory party split. And therefore, that's another reason why Mr. Cameron is banging the war drums in a vain effort to unite his party. He won't even succeed in that, you will see, at the end of the day. But when the Tory party is in difficulties, instead of uniting the party to proceed to an all-out offensive, on an issue, by the way, which will get massive public support in opposition to this madness, this fifth column inside the shadow cabinet has proceeded to is going to cross the floor. I don't know how many of them. Perhaps some of them will have second thoughts, but quite a few of them are going to walk at it on a decisive vote, defy the Labour Party, split the Labour Party publicly in the most scandalous manner, and go across the floor and vote with the Tories and Liberals. Isn't that a disgrace? Isn't that a scandal? Should that be tolerated? And you know what these people have got the audacity to say? They said it this morning. They were mourning to the press, oh look, Jeremy Corbyn is bullying us. We're being bullied, you see. Pressure is being put on us by our local constituency parties not to vote according to our conscience. They're being bullied. You know, you simply have to admire the sheer brazen audacity of these people. These individuals, these Blairites, for months, ever since Corbyn was elected, have been bullying him, have been harassing him. They've turned the shadow cabinet meetings into a bear pit where they mercilessly attack, harass, insult, hiss, boo, the elected leader of the Labour Party. And these people have got the brazen insolence to turn around and complain that they're being bullied. Good God, what is the world coming to? The fact of the matter is that these people now are beginning to realise that the rank and file of the party is fed up with them, is sick and tired with them and their antics. And of course, they will be called, I hope, and believe and trust, that these renegades, that's what they are, will be called to account. Oh, isn't it terrible? Don't talk about deselection. Oh, look, they're threatening to deselect me. Good heavens above. Have you ever heard of democracy, my friends? Isn't it democratic that local Labour parties have the right, the sacred right, the democratic right, to decide who should represent them and who not? Who's got the right to question this democratic principle? No. It's the sacred right of MPs. Well, I'm sorry, this is finished. This has got to finish. What one can't understand quite so well is why Jeremy Corbyn gave a free vote on this fundamental question. I believe that if he'd taken a hard line, or one or two of them might have resigned. I say good riddance to bad rubbish. Let them resign. Let them all resign. It's just ridiculous the way that this affair is being carried out. Probably his intentions were good. I don't doubt that. I know Jeremy. He's an honest person. And maybe he has the idea of trying to preserve the unity of the Labour Party. Now, I understand that. We're all in favour of unity. Unity to fight the Tories, yes, but you don't have unity by people who are constantly and persistently striving to split the Labour Party, to split the shadow cabinet, to vote with the Conservatives, as they're doubtless preparing to do this evening. That's not unity. In reality, it isn't just Cameron that's declared war on Syria. It's the Blairites that have declared war on the Labour Party. That's the real fact of the matter. And therefore, the conclusion is absolutely inescapable. These ladies and gentlemen who cross the floor, who vote with the Tories, who betray the Labour Party, who are preparing to split the Labour Party, there's no question of this. Frank Field said this, one of these creatures. He blurted it out. He said, well, you know, if one of us is deselected, we must all of us, how many is that? I'd like to know. Quite a few, I imagine. We all of us must stand against the Labour Party. Good heavens, they're excluding left-wingers because they might have called for a vote in a moment of insanity. Maybe they called a vote for the monster raving lunatic party. I don't know. Here is a Labour MP, Frank Holt, who's openly calling on Labour MPs to betray the party, to split the party, to stand against the party. What action has been taken against Frank Fields? I don't know. Nothing, I guess. Nothing. Well, it's about time that this situation was brought to an end. I say, with the greatest possible respect and comradeship and hope, I say to Jeremy Corbyn, Jeremy, you can no longer maintain this attempt of yours to maintain unity with people that are out to destroy the Labour Party. You will not succeed in maintaining unity because these people are hell-bent. They will split the party. I predict that now. They're on a course to wreck the party. And therefore, I believe that it is up now, not to Jeremy Corbyn alone, of course. It's up to all Labour Party members. It's up to local parties to take the necessary action to restore order in the House, to call these MPs to order. Either, you must say to them, either you are prepared to carry out party policy, to respect the leader, and to unite in a fight against the Conservative Party and to drop this support for an imperialist war in Syria, or you will be shown the door. You can leave, you can join the Conservative Party, you seem to have much more in common with the Tories than with us, and therefore we invite you to leave. If you're not prepared to go, then I think we'll have to set in motion the democratic process, yes, for deselection, to remove people that are not prepared to fight for Labour values and socialist values, and replace them, by all means, by many people, many honest, militant party members that are prepared to fight for socialism, for peace, for socialism, for democracy, for the values of the Labour Party. The future is in your hands, and I think that this is the only way forward.